There was no possibility of taking a walk that day. We had been wandering, indeed, in the leafless shrubbery an hour in the morning, but since dinner, Mrs. Reed, when there was no company, dined early. The cold winter wind had brought with it clouds so somber and a rain so penetrating that further outdoor exercise was now out of the question. I was glad of it. I never liked long walks, especially on chilly afternoons. Dreadful to me was the coming home in the raw twilight with nipped fingers and toes, and a heart saddened by the chidings of Bessie, the nurse, and humbled by the consciousness of my physical inferiority to Eliza, John, and Georgiana Reed. The said Eliza, John, and Georgiana were now clustered round their mamma in the drawing room. She lay reclined on a sofa by the fireside, and with her darlings about her, for the time neither quarrelling nor crying, looked perfectly happy. Me, she had dispensed from joining the group, saying she regretted to be under the necessity of keeping me at a distance, but that until she heard from Bessie and could discover by her own observation that I was endeavouring in good earnest to acquire a more sociable and childlike disposition, a more attractive and sprightly manner, something lighter, franker, more natural, as it were, she really must exclude me from privileges intended for contented, happy little children. And so begins my reread of Jane Eyre by Charlotte Bronte. I'm so excited for this vlog. This is going to be a really chatty and open discussion of the plot of Jane Eyre. So I just want to flag up right here at the very beginning, if you have not read Jane Eyre yet, please don't watch this vlog. Go away, read it, enjoy yourself, have the best experience of your life, come back and enjoy this vlog after you've read Jane Eyre. For everybody else, welcome. I am so excited to be doing a reread of Jane Eyre. This is going to be the first in a series of my rereads of the Bronte books, which I'm going to be reading along with Milena, Sarah, and Mary. I will link their channels down below, who are running the Bronte Along project this year, where they're reading all of the Bronte's novels. I found it so interesting just reading that very first page, how coming back to this text, you already notice so many things that you wouldn't perhaps have noticed the first time round. So it's really interesting when she talks about never liking long walks, especially on chilly afternoons, and how dreadful to her was that feeling of inferiority, of being on the outside. And it's just kind of already such a strong foreshadowing of the wandering scene where she has to wander on the moors for days as a beggar. It made me think it would be interesting to track a little bit the kind of indoors versus outdoors Jane, because obviously quite a lot of the key scenes that occur in Jane Eyre occur out of doors, like the proposal scene, for example. And the weather plays a huge role in this book in a very gothic way. I love that. You know, there's a lot of the pathetic fallacy, as it's called, where the weather mirrors the mood of whatever it is that's going on. I was also just thinking what a truly phenomenal job Charlotte Bronte does in this first page, these first, what, three paragraphs, at making us feel such a close bond with Jane so quickly. The first three paragraphs of Jane Eyre, we're told that she doesn't go for a walk. And yet by the end of them, we care for her so deeply. We already feel her outside status in the household. We feel the injustice of it. And the injustice and the irony of her being told that her natural way of being as a child is unnatural is just such a powerful way to immediately endear her to our hearts, I think. And to get us thinking about all of the social expectations of the age, of what makes a good child a good person, all things which I think are explored really interestingly throughout the novel. So, let's get reading.
Some of the best characters ever. The storytelling is amazing, and it's a whole experience.
Hey, it's Saturday, it's the afternoon. I thought I'd film from over here because my plant has got a new leaf unfurling and I'm really excited about it. So I'm up to the part where she's about to go to school. Basically, Mr. Brocklehurst is just about to visit them in the household. And so much happens at the beginning of this book. Like, when I sort of think about critically analysing Jane Eyre, I feel like so much actually hangs on those first few chapters. I mean, The Red Room is so early on in the book and is just like so powerful and atmospheric. I think I wrote a note as I was reading it about how in Jane Eyre, the supernatural is never made explicit, with maybe the one exception of the Jane, Jane, Jane calling by Rochester right at the very end. But it feels like the veil between the real world and the supernatural world is so fine that you can almost see through it. And one of my favourite and most loved things about Jane Eyre is not only the gothic element of it, but also the kind of almost fairy tale element to the story, which I think ties into the plot itself and certainly ties into the characterization of Jane. And yeah, the Red Room scene I just found so rich. Obviously it's so full of like the symbolism of the color red for passion, violence. I think, you know, like right in the beginning, she pulls the curtains around her when she's reading the book, the red curtains she pulls around her, almost creating like a nest, creating a kind of womb for herself. And yeah, I think that red colour links to life, to vivacity, and it's fascinating to see what a huge part it is of the beginning of the book. And also another thing that I've kind of noticed tied to red is how often fires are mentioned. She'll talk about like the embers of her passion. You know, the nursery fire dies down. There's just fire, candles, flames all around her everywhere. And you sort of have this contrast of the intensive passion that she feels, kind of paralleled with her quieter, more reflective self. And also the depression that she suffers. Charlotte Bronte, I think, is a wonderful writer on depression. I remember this. It's been a long, long time since I read Villette, but depression is definitely one of the themes of that novel, more so than it is in Jane Eyre, but I think she references and describes it wonderfully in Jane Eyre. And I love the way that in the child Jane, we see the roots of so many things in the adult Jane that kind of transform a little bit and change and either intensify or lessen as she gets older, like her passionate nature, her fierce desire for justice, but also her tendency to depression. Obviously when Rochester is kind of playing his trick on her, where he pretends that he's in love with Blanche Ingram, she gets really depressed, she does the two different drawings and compares them, she feels almost reduced to tears, and we see the same thing in the child Jane. It's such a rich text. You could just mine this for forever and get more and more and more out of it. And I think this is probably the thing I will keep coming back to throughout the vlog. I love to analyse Jane Eyre. There's so much in there, it's so rich, and yet the primary joy of this book is just this pure, intense connection that I have to this novel, and it just fills me with joy. It's such a wonderful reading experience. It's so gripping, it's so moving, even though I know now every tiny little twist and turn that the plot is going to take. The experience of walking that path is still so compelling, and I think that is just the mark of a truly incredible novelist. I am not surprised that I'm loving this, but I really, really am enjoying it so much. And the Psalms, I hope you like them. No, sir. No? Oh, shocking. I have a little boy, younger than you, who knows 6 Psalms by heart, and when you ask him which he would rather have, a gingerbread nut to eat, or a verse of psalms to learn. He says, oh, the verse of a psalm. Angels sing psalms, says he. I wish to be a little angel here below. He then gets 2 nuts in recompense for his infant piety. How dare you affirm that, Jane Eyre? How dare I, Mrs. Reed? How dare I? Because it is the truth. You think I have no feelings, and that I can live without one bit of love or kindness, but I cannot live so, and you have no pity. I shall remember how you thrust me back, roughly and violently thrust me back into the Red Room, and locked me up there to my dying day, though I was in agony, though I cried out while suffocating with distress. Have mercy, Aunt Reed.
And that punishment you made me suffer because your wicked boy struck me, knocked me down for nothing. I will tell anybody who asks me questions this exact tale. People think you're a good woman, but you are bad, hard-hearted. You are deceitful.
Yes, Jane.
And shall I see you again, Helen, when I die? You will come to the same region of happiness, be received by the same mighty universal parent, no doubt, dear Jane. Again I questioned, but this time only in thought. Where is that region? Does it exist? And I clasped my arms around Helen. She seemed dearer to me than ever. I felt as if I could not let her go. I lay with my face hidden on her neck. Presently, she said, in the sweetest tone, "How comfortable I am. That last fit of coughing has tired me a little. I feel as if I could sleep. But don't leave me, Jane. I like to have you near me. I'll stay with you, dear Helen. No one shall take me away. Are you warm, darling? Yes. Good night, Jane. Good night, Helen." She kissed me, and I her. And we both soon slumbered. When I woke, it was day. An unusual movement roused me. I looked up. I was in somebody's arms. The nurse held me. She was carrying me through the passage back to the dormitory. I was not reprimanded for leaving my bed. People had something else to think about. No explanation was afforded then to my many questions. But a day or two afterwards, I learned that Miss Temple, on returning to her own room at dawn, had found me laid in a little crib. My face against Helen Burton's shoulder, my arms about her neck. I was asleep, and Helen was dead. I find Helen's death one of the most moving parts of the book. I know a lot of people find Helen quite an annoying character, a bit, I don't know, overly perfect, too pure and good for this world, or whatever. But I just think, I think she's one of the best characters in the book. I love her friendship with Jane. I love the fact that through Helen, we see Jane's real first capacity to make a true and real and beloved friend in the world. And there's just so much fascinating stuff surrounding religion in here, and Jane's kind of questioning and doubting of religion in comparison to Helen Burns's pure, true believing, in comparison to Brocklehurst's really hypocritical and abusive use of religions, in comparison later on to St. John's manipulative use of religion. It's so interesting how religion in Jane Eyre isn't just one solid thing, but is this flux of many, many different ways of being and of seeing the world and of believing. And even though there is goodness in it, there is also cruelty there. And Helen obviously embodies all of the goodness. I also think Helen is such a wonderful contrast to Jane in terms of their characters. Jane at this point in the book is very passionate. She's very much about giving back what you receive. She has a very Old Testament kind of belief in justice, you know, an eye for an eye. Whereas Helen is the embodiment of the New Testament, turn the other cheek. And I think that Bronte is almost arguing for the path in the middle. Like, Helen Burns kind of loses her life to being too submissive, and Jane, I think when Helen goes, almost takes a part of Helen's soul on board with her as she moves forwards and is more, submissive is perhaps the wrong word, but is more patient, is more gentle, and that side of Jane's character, I think, is something that is such a process of maturity for her that we see as we go through the book. I also really love Helen because I empathised with her more as a child, and I guess even as an adult coming to it, I was way more of a scaredy cat than Jane. I don't think I would have spoken out in the ways that she does as a child, and even though I was obviously nowhere near as good as Helen, her philosophy of quiet submission was a lot more aligned to the way that I lived myself, and I really appreciated seeing characters like Helen being put forward as a way of being and as a good way of being in books. Perhaps it's one of the reasons why I loved Victorian literature so much, because I think I had a more Victorian child's disposition, which, as you're probably aware, if you're also a kind of sensitive and quiet person, doesn't necessarily feel like it has so much of a place in the world today. I think Helen is the beginning of Jane's realization that she is valued by other people, but through realizing that she is valued by other people, and through Helen's philosophy, Jane also begins to really establish that incredibly strong sense of self-worth, which she embodies throughout the rest of the novel, which is what makes her probably my favorite heroine and role model out of all of the heroines and all of the books that I've ever read. And I think that begins in Helen, that begins with Helen's philosophy that even if the whole world hated you, you would still have a friend, you know, God would still love you, and you can draw strength from that. And that brand of Christianity is something so beautifully portrayed throughout the book. Hey, it's Monday and I thought I would chat a bit more about Jane Eyre. So I'm about halfway through now. I'm now at the part where Mason has just been bitten by Bertha and Jane has spent the night in the dark room with Mason. So since I last spoke to you, we've met Rochester. Full disclaimer, I am one of those people who loves Rochester. Reading it now, I also definitely have to make the full disclaimer that, like, yes, I know he's an awful man, but there is something just so magnetic about Rochester. I emotionally love Rochester from the first moment that I meet him and love their love story and feel like Charlotte Bronte portrays love in a palpable way in her writing. The conversations between Jane and Rochester have always been my favourite part. I think one of my favourite scenes is when they have the first conversation where Rochester's talking about being hard as an India rubber ball, permeable perhaps by a chink. That scene lays the seeds of their love so beautifully and shows in a way which I rarely see shown elsewhere how love is a meeting of two minds. I'm fascinated by all the references to fairies, to spirits, to elves, to the otherworldly in Jane Eyre, as I mentioned when I started reading the story. I feel like there kind of is a fairy tale in the overarching narrative of this novel, of the poor orphan child who is homeless and friendless and yet ends up married to the love of their life and wealthy. That is quite a fairy tale-esque story in and of itself. And I love that Rochester sees that magic in Jane from the very first time that he meets her. I'm really intrigued by the kind of games and charades aspect of all that takes place at Thornfield Hall. With the actual charades scene, I realise that it has first a wedding and then Rochester being locked up in jail, which kind of predicts, you know, what he really deserves to be for planning to become a bigamist, which is obviously illegal. I still, at this point, need to have more of a think about and would be fascinated in your views about why Rochester plays so many games with Jane. I always just presumed that his ploy to trick her into believing that he was going to marry Blanche was his attempt to make her jealous because he is a man who has been very influenced by jealousy over the course of his life, and he didn't know a better way of making her fall in love with him. But I still don't know why he goes to quite such extremes with his game playing. There is definitely that kind of weird balance between things being amusing and things being dark and scary. Like, all of Rochester's hiding Bertha's existence from Jane kind of feels like a bit of a sick game. I mean, there's the reference to Bluebeard's castle, I think, which is made of, you know, someone who's got their dead wives all shut away in a chamber. Rochester has effectively killed his first wife and locked her away, and Jane is going to discover that, but, you know, he's trying to play about with her to make sure that she doesn't. Yeah, I don't know. I think there's some really interesting stuff in there. I haven't quite put my finger on the meanings of all of these games and charades and stuff that goes on, but I think it's fascinating. Hey, it's Wednesday. Yesterday was Valentine's Day, which was a lovely day to have in the middle of rereading this romance, and I am about three quarters of the way through, as you can see. A lot has happened. It's such a packed book. I feel like at every chapter you could say a lot has happened. But some of my thoughts from the Rochester Bertha stuff. One thing that's really interesting that I'm finding now, which I feel like is a sign of me maturing, is that I am really enjoying the romance plot. I do love it, but I feel like I kind of love it more for old time's sake than necessarily in and of itself. My favourite part of the story by a country mile is all of the Jane stuff, and the other characters, yeah, just like Rochester just doesn't feel as central to the plot to me as he used to. Something that I've kind of been picking up on this time is the different like attitudes towards life between Jane and Rochester, particularly in terms of kind of self-determination. So like, I feel like Jane just takes a lot more responsibility for her life really at every point, whereas Rochester is constantly trying to blame circumstances. And I think Jane's ownership of her own life and her choices when she has actually had significantly fewer opportunities to make choices than Rochester in her life. I just think that's something so admirable, and I'm constantly reminded why I love Jane so much and why she is such a fantastic role model for me to have had throughout my life and to continue to have now. Regarding Bertha, I definitely feel like she is a plot point rather than a person, which is such a shame. I think she is almost presented as a devil-like figure, and she does bring fire and suffering and purgatory in a way. I know that we haven't got there yet, but obviously with like the main fire that happens more towards the end of the novel. However, even within the time that Jane is at Thornfield, she tries to burn Rochester to death in his bed, and she does not damage Jane, even though she goes into her room and destroys the veil. It's almost weirdly like a kind of protective act, right? To be like, you can't get married to this man. A marriage to this person would tear you in two. I could really do with rereading Wide Sargasso Sea, which I haven't read since university. I think as a modern reader, you do read Jane Eyre and see the way that Charlotte Bronte describes Bertha, and you do just feel like there's kind of a bit of a void there. She doesn't come into the text very much at all. She mostly exists as this kind of disembodied laugh, almost as a spirit. If it wasn't for all of the animal comparisons that are made when she actually exists physically, I would see her as like a ghost or an otherworldly bringer of justice. I have been enjoying every second, of course. I love the proposal scene. I just think Jane's words are fantastic. And I also adore that moment of symbolism where the lightning strikes the tree in the middle of the night and then young, innocent, possibly offspring of Rochester, Adele, comes to tell Jane about it the next day. I just think it's just bursting with so much meaning. I'm just in the middle of the wandering scene, which I find an incredibly painful but really fabulous part of the book. Is where we just see how much strength of character Jane has, and it blows my mind every time that she's only supposed to be like 18 or 19 at this point in the book. Like, 18 or 19, when I think about how fragile I was back at that age, and when I think about how now I don't know that I could withstand the manipulation and challenges that Jane goes through and the hardships without kind of breaking, I just love and admire and respect her so much. She's such a great character. Final thoughts. I love this book. The St. John stuff. I really don't like St. John. I know nobody does. It's weird though, because he's so toxic and manipulative, but like, also so is Rochester, and I guess the only difference is that I do think Rochester believably does love Jane, whereas St. John obviously doesn't love her at all, and she doesn't love him back, except as a brother. I always find it really painful to see the way that he like almost breaks her, and I'm always so relieved that he doesn't. Even though I know the story so well, there always is this moment where you worry for a moment that she is going to get with him. And I remember when I first read it and I didn't know the plot, like, she doesn't go back to Rochester until really the last, what, two chapters or so? And so I remember for so long, I was like, it's nearly over and she hasn't gone back to Rochester. She's still with St. John. Like, is she actually gonna marry this guy? So yeah, always very relieved when she doesn't. Something I've been reflecting on as I've been reading this time is naming and people's characters and like the elements. I know I mentioned at the beginning of this vlog that I was kind of intrigued about like Jane indoors versus outdoors, and I haven't really tracked that as I've been going through, but I have really been focusing on the kind of spiritual feel to this book
And like I mentioned right at the beginning, even though I intellectually, for example, don't like Rochester, I still feel such an emotional connection to him and such an emotional connection to this book. And I'm kind of intrigued as to how on earth Charlotte Bronte does that. Like, it's not just because she addresses you as the reader that you feel like you care that much. I've read loads of books that break the fourth wall and address you as the reader, and mostly it makes me feel less connected to the book because it kind of reminds me that it's not real and therefore stops me from suspending my disbelief. I think the reason why I love Jane Eyre so much is just because of this spirit connection that manifests in so many ways throughout the book. And so, kind of linked to that, one of the things that I was thinking about was the elements, so fire, earth, water, and air, and how these link to the different characters and to the naming of the different characters. So Jane is compared to a reed a couple of times, a couple of key points throughout the book. There is after the not marriage to Rochester, when he's trying to persuade her to stay and he's holding her and he says, like a reed she feels in my hands. And then there is when St. John is trying to seduce, for lack of a better word, seduce her, and she says that she becomes flexible as a reed under his kindness. A reed I'm kind of associating with the earth. Jane obviously is not a reed. The reeds, as a family, they exist in the book, but Jane is not a part of them. They never accept her. Whereas she is an heir. Heir, Jane's surname, is obviously a homophone with heir, the heir around us. And I think that really links to her kind of deep spiritual nature. We then have St. John Rivers, river being water, all the characters are so well named. And I think, like, rivers, it kind of relates to baptism, to St. John's really powerful, strong mission in life, because obviously, I mean, the last paragraph kind of reminds you of this. He has this vocation, this calling, and also this ambition to be a missionary, which at the time was a thing that was seen as being like an extremely worthwhile and worthy thing to do with your life. And he drives towards that goal at the exclusion of everything else, in the same way that a river with a strong current, you know, will flow to the sea. And I think it's really interesting seeing how the characters all kind of flow towards their own destiny throughout this book, but St. John more powerfully than any others, and he tries to sweep Jane up with him, but you know, air cannot be swept up by water, and she doesn't, fortunately, go to India with him. We then have Helen Burns, who I have been thinking about throughout the whole novel. As I mentioned, I wanted to when I read the Helen scene at the beginning. I just love her. And I think Burns is such an interesting surname because on the one hand, you immediately think of burn, fire, hugely symbolic thing throughout the novel. And she obviously has that passion for Christ, that love for Jesus, which supports her and comforts her when she dies. And I think what she also kindles in Jane. Jane is quite skeptical of religion at the point where Helen dies, but comes to depend upon her relationship with God a lot more as the book goes on. But Burns, or a burn, is a small stream in the dialect of like northeastern and Scottish English, i.e. where Helen is from. And so firstly, it's a significantly less powerful form of water than like St. John Rivers water. It's like the clear water that you can rejuvenate yourself from. And I think it also just mirrors the way that Helen Burns is this kind of, this perfect middling balance of fire and water, of heat and coolness. And I just thought that was really, really fascinating. And these themes of like hot and cold and the elements, they feel like such a big part of the book. You know, fire is something that is literally and metaphorically super, super dangerous. But at the same time, ice in the form of St. John's character and in the form of the terrible winter at Lowood is a genuine threat for the characters too. So yeah, that was something that I was kind of reflecting on during the last part of the book that I thought was really, really fascinating. There's obviously so many fascinating themes to this book. I love and adore it. Sorry, my battery just died like 2 seconds before I finished the vlog. I was saying I love and adore Jane Eyre,
and I was about to say that I would really love to hear your thoughts. I'm hoping that people who have watched this far in the vlog have actually read it so that I haven't spoiled anything for anybody. And yeah, I would just love to hear how you feel about this book, what kind of connections it has had with your life, because I think for so many people this is like genuinely a life-changing book, and the story of when you first read it and how it impacted you. I love hearing those stories. I'd love to hear any thoughts that you have about the themes in Jane Eyre, about the characters, really anything. Tell me all. I will happily discuss this novel eternally. And I really hope that you enjoyed hearing some of my thoughts and reflections throughout this vlog. One final thing, I'm joining Milena, Mary and Sarah for the live show, which will be done by the time that you post this vlog, so I will link it down below. Do go and check that out if you want more Jane Eyre chats. I hope that you're doing really well. I send you all my very best and I look forward to seeing you soon in another video. Bye bye.